So my name is Pete Batchelor. I'm a music technology innovation at the university. Sean Carroll, who is of various affiliations. So that was, were two of us involved in this venture. The third was Mark Towers, who leads the foundation degree at Leicester College. We all sort of approached it from different sort of perspectives and interests, and kind of on the strength of that MSP conference, 2 years running, very successful. Mark Towers is an Ableton whiz. Sound art analysis, in particular in the public domain. So between us, we came up with the idea for a public-centred festival that could explore sound art and related activity. So that's what this is all about. Explain where we were.
I think the main thing we wanted to do really was start a dialogue. And this would be based around the ideas of exhibition, discussion, and demonstration. Pete mentioned it was a lot about doing this work in the public space. This can mean a lot of things. We really wanted to work in a very public space. We were quite fortunate that High Cross Shopping Centre was one of our sponsors this year. They gave us a huge gallery. Which was actually a space that had been empty in the centre for quite a long time. This is literally what it looked like when we found it. It had been abandoned for several years, and the only people to have used it was a zombie. So they literally covered the walls with blood and left it like that. It wasn't real blood, I should say that before I go on. So after quite a bit of work, we managed to get it looking. And we were really fortunate enough to put some great work in there. Hopefully some of you managed to come down and see some of it. We were supported by the High Quest, as I said, MTI, Square Mile, and Arts Council England, the real supporters behind this. We were also fortunate to have some really good photos from the event.
Yes,
yeah,
so I
don't know
how visible those are, but I think what we were aiming to do was to make it fairly visible, fairly approachable, so the works that we decided to curate were of that ilk. There was quite a wide variety of stuff as well. So it's quite a lot of kind of neon and flashing lights, along with interactive exhibits. Hopefully things that people would engage with. It's basically this abandoned power plant unit, which is quite a large space that I think High Cross would be quite animated in some way.
It used to be a record shop, quite a long time. It was one of the largest record shops in the city centre. It was quite, so in that sense, it was quite nice to go in there when we went in. We found lots of abandoned listening posts and like play buttons across the board. So we thought it was the right location if we were going to be working in the city centre. The location had some kind of history with the site development.
And a reasonably large footprint.
It's just across from Waterstones. It's actually got another group in there now at the moment.
So that was the exhibition space. We also used that to house some doing activities. So it wasn't just about presenting works by artists, but also sort of encouraging someone to get involved. So we had Sean Clark, who's resident in Leicester, building these sound-making jars using the Arduino Nano, using it as a sound-responsive object, or a series of them. And then some top people kindly agreed to do some workshops on pom-pom making. Yeah, again, very grateful to those who supported us in that resources for us.
Yeah, I guess the next thing we wanted to really do is discussion and demonstration. Again, we were quite lucky that Cloud Theatre, which we're going to later, really supported the project. We're also lucky that Ableton, which is the company that you should be aware of, bought into the project. They sponsored us with quite a lot of support in terms of bringing people over to come and talk. Sky came actually from America via Germany to do a talk. A couple of other people did. This was supported again by NTI Ableton. We thought it was a really nice idea to have the talks after the exhibition. I guess we, in an ideal sense, we would have liked them to have been part of it, but just the location, moving the venues made that quite difficult. But we wanted to kind of put something on that people could look at and then have a chance to discuss it afterwards, I guess, which was a good part of that. Some of the talks, some of it was related to the exhibition.
So those were the various events, and because the whole point was to explore public engagement in these kinds of activities, one of the things this was all quite ambitious in terms of trying to bring together a variety of different activities. At the same time, so some of it was a little bit exploratory, and we would hope to develop further with future runnings of the Make Sound event. But as I say, one of the things we were hoping to do was to solicit some feedback on the event, and perhaps because it was about engaging the public, to see whether the public were indeed engaged in some capacity. So we were looking for various types of data to retrieve from that, and perhaps feedback from both visitors and participants in the event. This was partly so that we could feed back to the Arts Council, who kind of funded us, and say how successful it might have been, but also to just as a kind of exploratory research activity, and find out how people were perhaps migrating around the space. So there were various ways in which we did this, seeking to kind of gather data of various different ranges of a richness, if you like, from very simple, yes we liked it, no we didn't, to perhaps more detailed feedback. So we had we talked to a couple of people about this. We talked to Richard Fletcher, who is part of the arts management team, or certainly researching on their behalf at the Montfort. We've just gone right next door to him in the corridor, but barely spoke for a while, and that was extremely helpful for this. He was looking at new ways of gathering data using not alternative technologies, but accessible, readily available technologies, including Gerard time-lapse data. And using e-readers for simple data entry. We also spoke to Sophie Smith. This is something we didn't really implement, but we hope to do in the future, to do kind of interviews with visitors, maybe even taking footage of them walking around the space, which can then be played back to them while they recall why they might have stopped at a particular exhibit, what they might have thought at that time, and so on. We also had a post-it wall, which was essentially a kind of visitor's book and just providing various different comments. Interestingly, I don't know whether people are interested in the time-lapse footage. And it's kind of interesting. I don't know how... we haven't really looked at this in detail yet, but as I say, looking at people, how people navigate space, how they kind of cluster different objects and how long they might spend there and so on. I'm going to speed this up considerably. But as the day goes on, it was fairly quiet at certain times, and then at other times we get people spending more time at particular exhibits. In particular, what you see, Mark happened to be setting up on this particular day. You see lots of people kind of gathering around and looking at this. Again, I don't know how it might compare to other exhibits or exhibitions. So this one related to sound and people require it needing to be at certain places, certain durations. So. So that was that. Some data from the e-reader stuff. You can't really see this, but we were looking just to get a sense of how people might describe the exhibition to other people. And I suppose these are kind of marketing focus, but they're still useful for us. Yeah, quite a few people were saying it was unique, so they obviously think it's generic, which is nice. Contemporary, surprising, well-produced, and so on. We didn't have too many people saying it was unoriginal or poorly presented. Was it easy to understand the works? So I suppose from a sort of intention reception point of view, or seeing how well presented the works were from the point of view, some of them are easy to grasp, some of them are perhaps more difficult to grasp in terms of the rationale behind them. Most people seem to find things fairly easy to understand, including the information sheets. And I think what was particularly helpful in terms of the way we had this running was that there were all of the, we had a number of volunteers that we haven't really had a chance to say thank you to, but we had some fantastic volunteers both from within Music Technology Innovation and Leicester College and more further afield. And of course we were all hanging around in space, and every time somebody walked through the door it was sufficiently not crazy that we could sort of introduce what was going on, actually walk people around, tell people what was going on as they walked around. Which I think perhaps you're not going to have so much in gallery environments, and we thought it was particularly helpful in this case. So bless them for being there and for being so helpful and enthusiastic. Presentation, there seems to have been a reasonably positive response to that. In terms of feedback to the high cross, 98% of people seem to be enjoying it and would like to see more of this in the future, and perhaps to explore sound and sound out and sound capacity. I mean, obviously these are skewed, this one at the top in particular, since if people weren't interested in what was going on, they wouldn't come to the store in the first place. And then this one down here, we have quite a few people who were engaged in sound out. But even so, we also sought responses from people involved in presenting both at the exhibition and at the symposium and workshops. I think a lot of these are an outcome of us trying to do things in a very short period of time. We'll promote that next time. There being, we intend there to be a next time. I think these are all three little issues that we can address for next time, but ultimately it seems to have a fairly positive experience. One thing perhaps we did inevitably find was that there's a degree of bleed between exhibits. And one of the issues we were trying to encourage people to actually walk into the store by having enough noise that people could hear what was going on. We found it walking about 5 metres outside the shop front, and we really heard very little. And in fact, the head of High Cross came up and at one point said, "Well, we thought we could hear loads and loads of activity." So she said, they turned everything up, which of course had the disadvantage that there were various exhibits which were somewhat obscured. So that's a balance we need to address, but one that's inevitable again, that you don't come so much, particularly one where you're trying to say, you know, I agree with you. Anyway, so the future, well, we've already had discussions with Jack and Louise about how we might develop some kind of collaboration between what they're running superbly well, I think, today. What we're doing with a view to think how we might develop both projects. we looked at sound art and sound sonic art, perhaps more broadly speaking, for the purposes of this event. Next time we'll explore something a bit more thematic in terms of perhaps how any of the particular other disciplines. So we can get making sound in relation to education.